Hello, hello, everybody. It is 10:04 p.m. Central Time on the 19th of May, 2018. It is Saturday night here in the States. Going into Sunday, hope you're doing well. And we are here on the Earthquake 3D live stream and broadcasting to you live from the deep woods of Missouri. Came up out of my bunker just to come into my house, to come down into the basement to do this broadcast live, bringing to you the list of earthquakes provided to me by the U.S. military, providing me the locations of all the earthquakes they're causing with their radio wave frequency devices. Just kidding, guys. We are here having a good time, and we're here to talk about seismic events that have struck since yesterday at my update last night at 10 p.m. You're welcome to go check that out. It's over on my YouTube channel, along with my weekly earthquake forecast, which we do on Sunday nights. Put it out over on YouTube so people can keep track of areas that we're watching. That all being said, let's get into the earthquakes that struck since last night. We will start here in the Central Pacific with a 5.0 earthquake, and we have subsequent activity. A new 2.1 up next to Mauna Kea, and a 2.3 striking at Mauna Loa. New 5.0 activity striking back near Kilauea, and we have ourselves some explosive activity again reported out of the crater. And if you're not aware, we talked about this last night as well, and you can go check it out in my video. The crater at Kilauea expanded by 34 acres. It collapsed in that last big blast. Well, another blast happened today, and we need to go look up these other two earthquakes, since this 2.1, for instance. I'd like to pull the coordinates, go look it up. I mean, on light of the 5.0 activity, this one's right at 1 kilometer depth, so really shallow. But it's just a microquake. However, microquakes at Mauna Kea and Mauna Loa are just something that we definitely need to keep watch on, and it seems to be they're increasing in number right now, the number of events. Magnitudes, not so much so. They're kind of sticking in the 2-ish range, maybe going up to near 3 on the western side of Mauna Loa yesterday, down here next to Captain Cook, east of Captain Cook, west of the crater of Mauna Loa. Somewhere right in here yesterday, there was a similar sized earthquake. And now today, look, all the way up here to the north on the northern flanks of Mauna Kea. And that is related. These volcanoes are starting to move a little bit. Now, why? Well, obviously, Kilauea has fully drained down thousands of feet, and the inner crater has collapsed. Here's a shot from 2016 of the inner crater. This is now 34 acres bigger. It goes out much larger. So when this lava lake refills, whenever that is, it's going to be bigger. And it's probably going to continue to grow a little bit in size with each one of these blasts that's occurring out of the crater there. This is on top of Pu'u'o'o already collapsing. That's what kind of set this whole thing into motion. Whole thing actually was set in motion by the surging magma chamber at Kilauea that came up over the top here first. Then Pu'u'o'o collapsed, and all the contents of Pu'u'o'o started to drain out over to the east towards Lalani Estates and out to sea. Well, now since then, Kilauea has fully drained down thousands of feet, and we're seeing activity now, earthquake-wise, spread out across Mauna Loa and Mauna Kea. I'm not saying they're going to drain. I'm just saying their magma chambers, there's something, a little slight perturbance that's going on. It's obvious that's why there's small earthquakes that are happening there. And new fluid flows of magma. So, you know, the chunky, more viscous lava that was coming out, now we're seeing, well, it's a newer type magma. So we're talking lava that's coming out at the surface. And it is much more liquid-like, which means that's the fresher flow. And they were talking originally about a subterranean magma deposit down below Lalani Estates from the 1950s or 60s or something. Well, I think that's being replaced now by what's coming out of Kilauea. I think that's pretty obvious. And you guys can go check the videos on that. Don't want to step on anybody's toes. Copyright-wise, everybody's being a little, you know, funny about that kind of stuff. They all want to try and get credit for it. I understand, but I'm not going to show it on my live stream. I don't want to get shut down. That all is a mess. So we'll get back out, look at the 5.0 earthquake, look at the stack that's going on. The stack, each one of these, is as the magma is punching through different layers of bedrock. We already know about that, and it's ongoing. The only difference here now is that Mauna Loa and Mauna Kea, oh yeah, we need to go look up this one as well. So we just looked up the earthquake at Mauna Kea, and now we'll look up Mauna Loa's earthquake. I want to show you. I'm going to show them to you each day as they're developing. No one else is talking about this. Everybody else is still focused on Kilauea and Pu'u'o'o. But when I start seeing stuff like this, I just want to make note of it now so we can reference it back in the future if we need to. Mauna Loa's last eruption was 1983. And if it does start to go, you'll know it. You'll see a whole bunch of activity, not just a few small earthquakes. But that's the update for Hawaii, so things are still a-moving. And we get down here to the Southwest Pacific, and we have 5.0 activity also going down into New Zealand. So let's start here with another deep earthquake. That was last night going into this morning, the 4.4, and it's down at 566 kilometers deep. Right next to it, look guys, Tonga, 5.5 and 4.9. How about that? New 5.0 has just struck as I'm talking here. We'll get to that in a second. It's marked in green here over next to Langila Volcano in Papua New Guinea. But let's get into New Zealand. Look what happened. The North Island got creamed, guys. New 4.5 and 4.0. This 4.5 is at 211 kilometers deep. It's a deep earthquake in its own right, which means we need to add on about a half magnitude, just a little less, and we could get a new 4.9 off this. But here it is. North Island has been hit exactly as expected, and we were expecting this to compress. The reason it was compressing? The activity to the north. The deep earthquakes coming down your way, and then sixes. Look at these. There you go. So the sixes, and then we went down a step, and we're at the plate boundary. Right at the Cook Strait, just south and west of Wellington. Take a look at it. That's where the biggest earthquakes struck. The other four, let's get that on the screen here, struck north and east of Wellington. Did I say south and west of Wellington? I mean south of Auckland, west of Wellington. And the 4.0 was north and east of Wellington. Here is the Cook Strait. And we were looking on the North Island towards the Cook Strait. There it is. So pretty interesting to see that all pop off in a day's time, going down from our deep earthquakes, 6.0s, then going down a step into New Zealand. As we go to the west, look at our 5.0 activity here. We just had a new 5 strike right on the tip of the peninsula coming out from Papua New Guinea. We have Langila Volcano here, which just erupted a day ago. And now we have a new 5.0 earthquake right next to it. Well, that's no shock. Look what's right next to it, a 5.2. So really, if you take a look at it this way, we have two sets of earthquakes, and then right in the middle is Langila Volcano. So I'm not shocked by that. That's normal. We normally expect that to happen. We'll see 5.0 activity spread out from these different volcanoes. As we go further to the west, we have new activity to report to you coming out of Java, Indonesia, or I should say Bali. New 4.0, 4.5, and then a new 5.0 earthquake struck in Sumatra, Indonesia, next to Mount Sinabung. Here's Mount Sinabung, here's Sumatra, Indonesia, and we have a new 5, or 4.9, depending on which way you want to go with it. Last night, new 5.1 struck at Malaysia. I think we talked about that last night. So if you guys missed that, again, a new 5.1. It's all the same size. If you really look at this, 5.0, 5.2, 5.0, 5.1. I mean, we're within a hair of a point of one another across 2,000 miles of the West Pacific. And really, if you really want to be specific, we can go into a 4.9, 5.0 up at Guam again. That's on next to the Mariana Trench. And don't forget the 5.0 out in Hawaii. So I'd say today's number, 5.0, is pretty obvious across the Central and West Pacific. Now let's get over towards Europe, but before we get there, let's go north of Madagascar. Again, a new 4.4 earthquake striking here. And this is really interesting because Africa's on the move, and they didn't report those earthquakes out of Chad, right here in Central Africa, a day ago. Well, it doesn't matter whether they report them or not, guys. Africa's getting pushed, and I think you're very familiar with what's going on. Pressure comes out from here, right where our earthquake is. Look where our arrow points. And we have an earthquake, a set, many that have struck over several days, a huge swarm, I could call it, right there over several days' time, and it went into Africa. We saw a 5.0 earthquake strike in Africa, but they didn't report them onto the public. We had to go to the seismologist page for study and go study those ourselves. As we go over into Europe, who got hit today? Two sets of fours, one in North Italy, and one in Albania down at the Greece border. at the mouth of the Adriatic Sea east of Italy. So 4.7, 4.6, depending on which agency you go with, right here. And we have a new 4.2 on the plate boundary in North Italy, and this fulfills the forecast. I'm glad I told you yesterday that we were going to slightly change the forecast to the north, and look what happened today. So all the signs were pointing to North Italy, and Mother Nature picks the spot. I was looking in Italy. Why were we looking in Italy? We have to go back a day. Look at this. See this five? This five struck first, and look at our arrows coming out from Greece. Now look what struck. 4.7, 4.2, going out across Italy, just as expected. So really, we go 5, 4.7, 4.2. We're taking steps down across the plate over the course of a day, 24 hours, the fours. And the 5 hit on the 16th, 3 days ago. So 5 hit first, we wait 2 days, then we go forward into today, and boom, and boom. That's normal. It's following the arrows. It's right on the plate boundary. We talked about this last night. You can go watch my video on YouTube. It's not an exaggeration, guys. I was zooming right in here telling you to watch for mid-range 4 activity, and it hit today. And I told you we're still watching Central Italy at Norcia, and I was leaning towards Norcia, but Mother Nature is leaning to the north. And who are we going to go with? Well, I think now we know which one to go with, right? If we start to see a swarm develop out next to an area I warn, I'm going to go with the swarm that develops out as opposed to the area I warn, even though there are, I mean, what is that, 200 miles, 300 miles? I don't know how far that is, 300 or 400 miles maybe, difference at the most. So there you go. There's the earthquake. Now, downstream, what else hit? Well, look, today, North Spain got a 3.5. So pressure is transferring across southern Europe, and it's going to be going out this way to the Azores. We may even see new 4.0 activity before my forecast tomorrow night pop up out here at the Azores. And since Albania and Bosnia were hit, guess who else is going to get hit? Poland, North Sea, going out to the north, north of Iceland, south of Svalbard. That may also happen tomorrow before my update. I'm going to have a new forecast out tomorrow. Now, we went up into the mid-range 6 so far this week. We have not seen a 6.5 over here yet. Yet. As we get into Central and South America, let's do South America first. How about another 5.1? Just for posterity's sake, how about another 5.0 to 5.1? And look at that. South Sandwich Islands again. So, and this one struck first. So first this one struck, 5.1. Then this one struck. And our time frame on this is, let's see, the 19th at 6:43 UTC and the 19th at 18:25 UTC, 12 hours apart. It took 12 hours for the force to transfer from here, underneath, and strike down here. And it lost 0.1 magnitude in the process. Now, here's the deal. The force that I'm talking about, this seismic force, first of all, it's always going to be with us. Secondly, it's traveling across the plates in a close proximity within a few thousand miles within a short period of time. And is a few thousand miles close proximity? Yes, geologically speaking. So we're talking about from going to here down to here in 12 hours, this force travels. And it drops off two similar sized earthquakes, 5.1, 5.0. Okay? And that happened today in the last 24 hours. As we go to the north, we get into Central America, and we have volcanic eruptions at Popocatépetl yesterday and today. Fuego yesterday. Let's go check the Volcanic Ash Advisory Center and just quickly see who's on here. Kilauea, of course. Sabancaya in Peru. Kilauea again. Sakurajima in Japan. Reventador in Ecuador. I'm checking to see if Popocatépetl and Fuego or any of these. Mount Agung. Keep going down the list. No, okay. Today, Central America, no eruptions. Popocatépetl, no eruptions. Fuego, no eruptions. Turrialba, no eruptions. But what do we have going on? Well, we have earthquakes striking in between two volcanoes, in between Popo and Fuego. And then we have earthquakes striking right next to Turrialba volcano in Costa Rica itself, next to our letter V. Gonna have to say that's probably going to be leading to a new eruption. I don't forecast eruptions, but Turrialba just went off like 5 blasts just the other day. Now we're having new earthquakes next to it. Probably going to light up here again. But look, this is low for Central America. I mean, to get a couple 4s and no eruptions, it may be building into something a little bit larger right here before the end of the weekend. So watch out tomorrow in Central America and Mexico, in our warned area in the Gulf of California, just in case. We'll just wait for that and see if anything develops. Now, let's talk about this. This is really interesting to me. What just happened in California today? A new 3.5, 3.2, and swarm of 2s hit down here at Riverside at the Anza Gap slow slip location. And to see everything, let's go look at the last, 24 hours of 0.0 and greater earthquakes. We have to look at the microquakes to get a good idea of what's going on. Now, here's everything since last night. You see this? So we have a couple stacks of earthquakes, and we go over to the Midwest. We have a single earthquake over here at the panhandle of Oklahoma at the pumping operations. We get down here into southwest Utah, and I'll go pull this. This is an earthquake that struck at 5.6 kilometers deep right next to Dutchman's Draw Volcano. And the only reason I know it's there is because we've had to look it up before. So Dutchman's Draw being hit, guys. But we get down into Southern California and look at it. You can see a diagonal line. Sometimes it's hard to see. This time it's clear. You can see from east of LA. This is LA in the green portion here. We go down to the east-southeast, down to Salton Sea. That's Salton Butte, so it's a volcano. Well, starting east of LA, we have a series of pumping operations. And I've shown them a lot of times. We'll go pull one up right now and get our coordinates here. So let's go put them in. Hopefully I still have my place marks there. I had to redo my place marks last year. Lost a lot of them, but we'll see if they're still there. Yeah, okay, we are. So we're right next to Mount Baldy, and we always look, of course, within 6 to 10 miles. On the other side of here, just on the other side, you see this? We have a bunch of mining operations, and they'll show up as explosions. On this side, same distance, look what we've got. Oil and gas wells spread out here, and I don't have all of them marked. I mean, I've just got one place mark here for this operation, but I think we can go even further and look at this. You guys are welcome to go up in here and pull all of them, but we go pretty close. I mean, I'm going to have to say there's probably some others that are up in here in the foothills around the area where the earthquake is striking. We always look within 6 to 10 miles, but it is definitely right next to those pumping operations. And that moved just slightly. So it's east of the LA Basin is where we start. We go down to the south and we go across this huge stack. I've got some links down below in the description box if you want to check it out. For the slow slip in Southern California at Riverside from the University of California, Riverside. And they announced in October that this was slow slipping. As it's slow slipping, the plate is in motion, the North American plate and the Pacific plate. This is picked up in pace and in magnitude. So we're seeing the number of earthquakes, the frequency increase, and we're seeing the power, the magnitudes, also increase right now. Well, that's just right here. We go up to the north, and yesterday's swarm at the nuke test sites at Pahrump, Nevada are gone. And instead, we're replaced by a few onesie-twosies 0.0s. Right at the same locations next to Doomtown and those, you know, hundreds of underground nuke test sites right at the location I showed you last night. You want to see them? Go check them out over in my video from last night. Don't want to waste too much of your time showing you holes in the ground that are only having 0.0 earthquakes at this point. We go over to the Nevada-California border and we go back over to the Yubihibi craters and we'll pull these coordinates. Goldfield, the 60 kilometers from Goldfield, but really at the location we're right next to some old dormant volcanic chambers. So let's go take a look. There we go. So we are right next to Smithsonian marked Yubihibi craters, and we'll zoom in on it. Looks like a mountain from on the top, but we'll bring it in an angle and bring you down inside the crater. You know, look up on the sides, you understand we're actually looking at a blast point in the ground. That's not a spot where a meteor has impacted. We have other cones and cinders surrounding this younger formation. And then over to the west, older, over to the east, older. So it's part of a greater lava field or volcanic field. But the lava that's exposed here, the black basalt, and you can still see it here on the surface. And there's our earthquake in the basin right next to it. Going up to the northwest, we get next to Crater Mountain, going up to Whitmore Hot Springs and Mammoth Mountain. So Crater Mountain here, we'll go pull this, Round Valley, California, okay. Right next to a place called Crater Mountain. They're giving us, again, USGS triangulated coordinates are a little bit different. Okay, so here we go. Here's Crater Mountain right here. And I'll just show it to you. There's lava flow. And then we come up to Whitmore Hot Springs right here. And here is Mammoth Mountain volcano right next to it, right there. Kind of hard to see. And boy, it's a ski resort, but it's also an active volcano. It's not going to erupt. None of these are going to erupt, guys. Don't worry about that. These are getting pushed as the plate is being displaced, which seismic activity, different than volcanic activity, although these volcanoes do become excited as the pressure transfers across the area. Now, on the other side of the border is Aurora Bodie Crater, right across from Mammoth Mountain, right here, where the other swarm is happening in the basin below it. So Aurora Crater here, and Mud Springs Volcanic Butte right next to it. Pretty cool. 300 feet high off the desert floor, big lava flow, and it's a part of the greater Mono Lake volcanic field. Up here to the north, Sugarloaf Volcanic Butte and the Buttes Butte. So we'll pull these coordinates and show you what's there. I have all the locations memorized, guys. Why do I have them memorized? We've seen so many swarms break out at each one of these volcanoes that I can just name them off on a list without even really having to look. So here we go. Okay, so let's zoom in a little. Oh, wait. Where are the Buttes Buttes? I told you I didn't get them all, okay? I didn't get all my place marks downloaded again. But my longtime viewers have them downloaded. Maybe I'm missing this. Maybe I'm looking on the wrong spot. No, I'm not. Not looking at the wrong spot. Okay. Whatever, guys. We'll try and get those downloaded again properly. We'll go to the north of Lake Tahoe. You're just going to have to take my word for it. We'll go to the north of Lake Tahoe, and we got some 0.0 activity. And again, this is not even worth showing to you other than let you know it's on the north shore of Lake Tahoe. We are south of Reno, where our swarm just hit over the past few days at the geothermal pumping ops. But this is next to nothing. Everything is transferred to the south. I think it's pretty obvious. Swarm of threes, twos, ones, stacks, all around Southern California, and going down to the south, down to Dutchman's Draw. So the force that was here has transferred to here in the past day. As we go up to the northwest, our pressure gauge is also showing low pressure here. Well, when this sucker starts to go down, as the force has already come across, there's something rebuilding up here to the northwest. No doubt about it. Let me show you something else that's going on. Let's go consult the real-time tremor map from the University of Washington. This is showing us the slow slip in the northwest. Now, I've already talked about the slow slip down here, and we've been talking about it for a year or more. So, I mean, come on. Since they announced it, we've been talking about it since October, but we were talking about this before they announced it, and I just got the confirmation in October when they released the studies. So before that, it was still going on, and we were saying, look, there's something going on here. It's swarming, it's swarming, it's swarming. Well, all the way up the coast, it's been moving, going up to here where this is dropping. Well, further to the north, look at this. Slow slip, 3 hours, last 3 hours, last 6 hours, last 12 hours, last 24 hours, last 48 hours. All these little red dots are small vibrations detected as the plate is going into motion, specifically in Northern California, west of Yreka, and across Northwest Washington at the Olympic Peninsula, going down to Olympia, and a few going right up to the Strait of Juan de Fuca. So the plate is slipping up here to the northwest. We don't have very many earthquakes to report to you at all, as the plate is literally, quite literally, I hate it when people, you know, overuse the word literally, the plate is moving right now. And it's detected with all those small vibrations as it shifts. Well, as the plate is shifting up here to the north, We're seeing a drop-off in activity here in Northern California. Well, let me show you where the other cluster is. So here we are in Northern California. Here is the area west of Yreka. And what's just southeast of there? Mount Shasta and this huge, huge series of vents. Why, you could call these separate volcanoes, separate shield volcanoes, separate lava flows. They're all tied to Mount Shasta overall, the greater stratovolcano there. And we are right next to it. So the plate is shifting next to Mount Shasta as a swarm is ongoing of tremors, not earthquakes. Again, these tremors are vibrations, not to be confused with fractures in the crust like all what's going on down here. You can call this a slow slip, but these are all earthquakes, meaning that the slow slip in Southern California isn't just vibrations. It's actual fracturing going on, and that's why we're getting 3.0 earthquakes. The plate is in motion, which means the area in between Southern California and the coast of Washington is under serious stress and going to go into motion soon. I would suspect off the coast first, then down in California second. And this force that we're talking about here is coming from the greater Pacific. That's why Hawaii is going. It's why the volcanoes are going. It's why increase in activity has come from our deep earthquakes. And it's just been like the frog in the pot. I was talking about this being like 2011 at the start of this last week. So over 7 days ago, talking about how, you know, hey, this looks like it's 2011. Guys, this is going on longer in Hawaii. The deep earthquakes are carrying on longer than in 2011, and we haven't seen a follow-up large earthquake yet. And that's troubling me because we haven't seen anything large except for at Hawaii when the magma literally, again, burst out of the ground and caused a 6.9 earthquake, as it did so, forming huge fissures. That 6.9 in Hawaii was an earthquake. It certainly was, but the earthquake was caused by the moving magma down below the plate. And when it punched up out of the ground, like an explosion almost, you get seismic signatures that somewhat resemble earthquakes, but it didn't. It more looked like an explosion coming out of the ground there with that 6.9. If you go look at the charts, you know what? I'll go pull them for the next time for our next broadcast tomorrow night and show them to you. And we can just take a look at them and compare them to other earthquakes. And it doesn't exactly look the same. Okay, so you understand now what's going on. We're waiting for an earthquake to strike off the coast. The plate is in motion on the west coast of the U.S. We don't have any earthquakes reported out of an area that is right now slow slipping. We have volcanic activity out to our west that's huge going on in Hawaii. If you're in Hawaii one more time, you're seeing activity now hit at Mauna Kea, Mauna Loa, and let's not forget about the other earthquake out at the volcanic field 30 miles off the western coast of the Big Island that happened yesterday. So that's not done. We are still ongoing with the event at the middle of the plate. And they say, the professionals say, that the event in the middle of the plate is not related to any of the other activity that's going on around the rest of the plate. And that the activity here just goes on from time to time. Wrong. Wrong, wrong. We see big increases in Hawaii when the rest of the plate is also increasing, when there's pressure created down below the plate through deep earthquakes. Deep earthquakes are a force that's coming up on the underside of the plate. And when it spreads out across the plate, which it doesn't just stop in those areas where the deep earthquakes are. It spreads out across whole regions and the whole plate if we get enough deep events. And we certainly have had enough when we've reached over 135 different deep events in the last month. That's a big deal. And we're still ongoing now. You can see the deep earthquakes raised high off the globe here. That's just in the past few days here in the West Pacific. So big pushes down below equals up above. We start to see things happen. Not just in Hawaii, we're also seeing a rise at Mount St. Helens, Mount Rainier. We saw a swarm at Mount Yellowstone. I hate it when people call it that. Yellowstone, super volcano. And technically, I guess it's a mount, but it's not. And then we saw all the pump points get hit. So drill points, fracture points where humans have created, whether it's oil, gas, geothermal. And that's all happened this week. It spread out from here and went out to Europe, causing the exact activity we were looking for down to a few distances that I think are acceptable. Let's go look this up. I just want to see how far off I was from my warned area on Sunday night this past week. Just curious. Because for my people in Italy, tanto amore, much love. And when I issue a warning for you, if I'm off by 100 miles or a couple hundred miles, I take it serious. So I just want to know why and where. Okay, here we go. So we are at Parma. We're on the plate boundary. There's no doubt about that. Let's consult the USGS plate boundary map just to show you what I'm talking about. I showed it last night, but we'll show it again today. So here's our red line going through Italy from the USGS showing us our plate boundary. You'll notice, let me let it load here. You'll notice it comes across Turkey and goes around Greece, goes up into Italy, dead ends into Torino. And the new earthquake struck right here next to Parma. Okay, so we're east of Torino, west of Parma, and we warned right here at Norcia. So we warned at Norcia, and it hit at Parma. So I'm going to measure between Parma and Norcia just so I can get a good distance to see how far off we were. All right, so let's do that. There we go. 218 miles. Let's just put it at 220 to be a rounded up number. Okay, and I try to get it within 200. So, you know, I mean, there we go. We talked about it last night, and there it is today. Mother Nature did it 200 miles to the north of our warned area with the exact magnitude we were looking for, 4.2 and a bunch of threes added together. And let's not forget my people in Albania, which is right at the border of Greece, going up to Macedonia. This is a pretty big earthquake for you guys. And this is going to be transferring up to the west-northwest as well. But I think it's going to go around. It's going to be going up and around to the west-northwest, which means Poland might be getting hit. But you know what? We've got Austria in the warning for this week. Still hasn't gone. I don't know. It'll all have to happen by tomorrow if it's going to happen at all for the forecast to be right. And that leads me back to you having an earthquake plan. The reason I do this is so that people can get a good idea of what's spreading out magnitude-wise. You can get a picture of what's happening, which way it's going. And I want you to have a plan and be ready for this. So if it comes your way, you'll be prepared and you'll be watching for it to happen, kind of like a storm coming your way. You can hope it dies out as it progresses in certain directions, but it's certainly a good idea to know which way a storm is going, right? Well, you're going to know which way the seismic storm is going. Look at our color coding. Dark pink equals older, white equals younger. And we go over to the west and our youngest earthquake striking, over to the west and our bigger earthquake striking a day ago, down here and mixed in between, we've got our deep quakes. There's only a few spots that we don't have any earthquake activity. Japan. How about Japan? One earthquake up in the Kuril Islands in the last day with a lot of eruptive activity at Sakurajima all of a sudden. We had three volcanoes going simultaneously about 4 days ago. Kirishima, Sakurajima, and Suwanizajima. Now, the other two have stopped, Kirishima and Suwanizajima, and Sakurajima just keeps going and going and going. That's on Kyushu proper. Well, you don't have any earthquakes to follow it up. Just put two and two together. You've got a bunch of eruptions happening. You don't have any earthquakes. Well, when the eruptions stop, guess what's going to be released? The Kraken. The seismic activity. It's going to be released out once the eruptions stop. And that's what we're talking about. So I'll be back on tomorrow night with a new forecast out for this week. But Japan already got hit with a 6 up here in Hokkaido. Sort of close to our warned area. I'm going to say that one's borderline as well, kind of like Italy, on the edge of the area that we warned. But hey, I'm trying my best, trying to get out warnings to whole countries, and if we can get it down inside the country, I'll be real happy. But if I can even get it by the country, I'm pleased. There we go. 10:38 p.m. Central Time. Do you know what to do when an earthquake strikes? If you're asleep, do you know what to do? If you're awake, do you know what to do? At work? At home? Do you have a plan? You should probably think about developing a plan. Just in your head. I'm not talking about writing it all down and putting on a backpack and boots and running around and saying, I've got an earthquake plan. No, you're just going to think about what to do when an earthquake strikes. So you're probably going to need to first take shelter, right? So if it's a moderate earthquake going on for a few seconds, you're going to realize an earthquake's happening and you're going to look around and say, okay, is it big? And if it starts to go on for more than just a few seconds, then you're going to be enacting your plan of taking shelter underneath a table or a desk. And things can fall, all sorts of things, plaster, ceiling-mounted fans, things can fall off walls, mirrors, picture frames. If it's a bigger earthquake that goes on for more than just a few seconds, you can start getting appliances that start sliding, refrigerators, unsecured washers, dryers, dishwashers that aren't screwed in right. Cabinets can even fall in large earthquakes. So you need to think about these things ahead of time, and you can go around your house and safeguard against a few of these things. But in other instances, people that live in heavy earthquake-prone areas or people that live in cinder block or stone structures need to have an exit plan. So let's say you live in an area where you get major earthquake activity usually. On a yearly basis, you might get 7.0, so in the West Pacific, in some of these island countries. Well, you need to have an exit plan. Even if you live in a frame house, you're probably going to want to get out of there in a 7 or an 8.0 earthquake because you have too many things falling around, flying around, and taking shelter underneath the table or desk. The table or desk might be moving around in those kind of earthquakes. So a lot of people like to exit. So if you're going to exit, you need to know what exit you're going to go out and where you're going to go once you're outside. You don't want to go outside and be guessing as to what could be falling your way. What if it's dark outside, middle of the night? You're on outside and things are falling. You can't see them falling from up ahead. Think about it. So little plans like that for what time of day the earthquake's going to be happening, and you need to have all those plans ahead of time and just have thought about it in your head. Now, if you're going outside, you should have an emergency kit. We call it a bug out bag as a slang term, but it's an emergency kit. It has the basic items in it that you need. And I don't know what your lifestyle is. I use the joke about, I think there's some disaster movie. It's some joking movie, a comedy of some kind. But the bachelors are all holed up in some kind of bunker and they've got like a Milky Way bar. They've got some beer. I think they've got some pot and some other stuff. And they're just there and that's it. You know, okay, well, if you've got that and you think that'll get you through, I'm here to tell you, you probably should have a little bit more than just the basics. And the basics can be met at the dollar store level. You don't have to go overboard above and beyond. And I'm not talking year-long supplies for prepping and staying inside for years. I'm talking about day one. And on day one, you're probably going to need a change of clothes, extra set of shoes. You might need an extra ID, insurance card, set of keys. Maybe a couple bottles of water and maybe some energy bars or something. Again, you're not going to be doing all this major eating and stuff on day one. Day one of a disaster, you're probably going to be either taking care of your property or trying to help someone else on any kind of major earthquake. And also first aid, a way of sanitation, a way of communication. And if you live in a city, you might want to think about self-defense, because some people might try and take that stuff from you if they see that you've got something that they don't and they need it. So all things you can prepare for ahead of time that are not, it's nothing scary. I use the term, the phrase, don't be scared, be prepared. And it really applies in a lot of scenarios in your life that to replace fear with preparation. And a lot of people in the military, firemen do this as well. I mean, come on, it's a scary event to go into a burning building to save someone, even if you're a firefighter, seasoned veteran. But through preparation and training and repetition, these people are able to enact their plans for conquering a scary situation. So instead of being scared, you be prepared, and you'll be way better off than everybody around you who's, you know, a lot of people are kind of scared. I think they're worried about people shaming them, about being a preparer or a prepper or whatever you want to call it. And you don't go broadcasting this to everybody. Yeah. So when you develop your earthquake plan or your survival plan, you keep it to yourself and your family at the most. Because what'll happen, and I've heard so many people talk about this, when a disaster happens, they'll just go to so-and-so's house because so-and-so is prepared and they've got food and water and they wouldn't turn me away, especially in a disaster. They're my friend. Okay, right? So think about these things, but keep them to yourself. And then, after the disaster happens, you can then branch out and help people accordingly as you want. And that's appropriate. It's always good, just in any kind of disaster, to first secure your situation, then branch out and absorb other people's issues. Like on an airplane, I talked about this last night. When you lose oxygen in an airplane, all the masks fall down. What do they tell you to do first? Put your mask on and then help other people. What good are you if you're passed out from lack of oxygen on the airplane? The same goes for a disaster. What good are you if you're injured or the burden on the rest of the people? You'd be much better off being prepared ahead of time, taking care of yourself first, then branching out to help the others. Okay, that's just my personal advice. And finally, how many people are here right now? I need to see. I like to check every night. If you're new here, will you please subscribe? We've got about 800 people in the chat room right now. Please hit that like button on the stream. It makes a difference to me. It makes me feel good. It doesn't do anything else other than that, I don't think. And also, guys, if you would like to share the information, I'm going to save this as a video over on my YouTube channel for everybody to see. Let's read off a few names in the chat room right now. You know, I've been doing this recently, and people like to hear their names read off for some reason. I guess it's kind of like being on the air. You know, you remember, you ever call the radio station to make a request, and you get to hear your voice on the air. I'll read your names out loud here, and we'll see who's in here right now. So, starting with the live chat, we've got Saint Rapture, Mooney, Sheila Deal, Obi-san, KB, Heart, 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 Josh Jameson, Rachel Flora, Rihanna Jones, Clusters 1.0, Coral Ray, Dana Whitis, Sweetis, Rihanna again, AJJ, West Coasted Up for Life. That sounds good. 2 Timothy 3, Bunny McIntyre, Dali Mama, Rebecca, everybody, Metalcore 357, probably. Dark Oracle, George Mitchell, Lester Peterson, everybody, King Crimson, you guys, word up to all of you. Christian Bearer, Copper Tropicals, Football Princess, come on, guys, this is going way fast. You know what? I'd have to be like the, do you ever see those old commercials where they read the, well, they probably still do it. I don't watch much TV anymore. Where they read the fine print at the end of the commercial. They read it really fast. Okay, I need to, the Micro Machines guy from the old 80s commercial. That's what I need to talk like. You guys are epic. You're all awesome for sticking with me and being part of this. In the Super Chat, Grace in Wonderland, Hooper, Kimberly Hernandez, Mooney, Gulf Coast Granny, Randy Fox, K. Evangelo, Gary DeStefano, K. Evangelo, Karina K., Randy Fox, K. Evangelo, Randy Fox, K. Evangelo, Randy Fox. And this goes into yesterday then, guys. Kim, Dragonfly, Randy, you guys, Megan, all of you. Going back to Wilma, you are awesome. You're